Hello guys, hope you all enjoyed Christmas. So today we are going to learn about Babur, Humayun and Sher Shah. On the eve of Babur's invasion, at the beginning of the 16th century, India was divided into numerous small kingdoms ruled by independent kings. The Delhi Sultanate had dwindled in size and its power only remained in some parts of Delhi. The political scenario was a scene of discord and disunity. Everyone was fighting with each other. There was no unity, and Delhi Sultanate had almost declined. So, this was the perfect time for a descendant of Amir Timur and Genghis Khan, Zahiruddin Mahmud Babur, to conquer Delhi Sultanate and India. So, let's know more about Babur. Who is Babur? Babur is the founder of the Mughal Empire. He lost his father when he was only 11 years old, and he became the ruler of a small principality in Central Asia called Fergana. At the age of 14, he fulfilled his dream of conquering Samarkand. But there was a bad news for him. Within a short time, he lost both Fergana and Samarkand and became a homeless wanderer. He wandered and wandered and wandered, but his extraordinary courage and zeal made him to conquer Kabul in 1504 CE. But still, all his attempts that he made to reconquer Samarkand failed. Then, how did he come to India? When did he attack India and invade India? So, in 1522 CE, Daulat Khan Lodi of Lodi dynasty invited Babur to invade India and throw away the unpopular king of Delhi, Ibrahim Lodi. It was a golden opportunity for Babur and he seized it. In 1524 CE, within 3 weeks of crossing Indus, Babur became the master of Punjab. Babur's small army was no match for Ibrahim Lodi's large army. Babur invaded India the following year and defeated Daulat Khan Lodi also, because Daulat Khan Lodi went against him. So, let's know about the battles that Babur fought to establish the Mughal Empire. The first battle of Panipat, which we are very known with. So, in this battle, Babur and Ibrahim Lodi came face to face in this battle. They both fought. So, as I said, Ibrahim Lodi's large army was no match for Babur's small, disciplined and loyal army with its excellent cavalry and fine artillery. Within few hours, Ibrahim Lodi and 15,000 of his soldiers lay dead on the battlefield. Babur was a born leader and an experienced general. The following day, Babur triumphantly entered Delhi, where he was proclaimed the Emperor of Hindustan. The Battle of Panipat was the first among many battles that Babur had to fight for a sovereign authority. So within the new kingdom of Delhi were ambitious Afghan nobles who were thirsting for revenge on Babur. Outside the kingdom was a powerful confederacy of Rajputs under the leader of Rana Sanga of Mewar. To make matters more worse, Babur's soldiers were war weary and homesick and did not want to fight any war again. So, what did Babur do? With his impassioned and eloquent speech, he he transformed his barbary soldiers into a regiment of heroes. So, second battle, let's learn. Battle of Kanba. In 1527, Rajput Confederacy under Rana Sangha, meaning hero of 100 battles of Mewar near Agra, clashed with Babur's authority at Kanwa, a village near Agra. As you all know, Rajputs are very brave. They fought with valor, courage, but still they were not able to defeat Babur because of his superior artillery and cavalry. The Battle of Kanwa was a more decisive battle. Was a more decisive battle than the Battle of Panipat. The Battle of Panipat gave him control over Delhi, but the Battle of Kanwa gave him superior control over central India. So, Battle of Chanderi. Again, Chanderi was also a Rajput stronghold in Malwa under Medini Rai. As usual, again in 1528 CE, Babur laid siege to the fort of Chanderi and captured it. Almost all Rajputs perished in this battle. After this, no Rajputs dared to challenge Babur's authority. So, last battle of Gagra. The rebellious Afghans in Bihar and Bengal had posed a threat to Babur's authority. In 1529 CE, Babur inflicted a crushing defeat to the Afghans. By 1530 CE, Babur became the master of Punjab, Delhi, and the Gangetic Plain as far as Bihar. Babur's memoirs. Babur had written an autobiography for himself called the Tuzuk-e-Babri. It is considered to be one of the most best autobiographies in the whole world. His detailed accounts and keen observations paint a graphic and fascinating picture of India at that time. It also says about his own personality, adventures and his achievements, manners and occupations, a dressing code of his countrymen, everything. His description of Hindustan includes a detailed and accurate account of its boundaries, population, revenues, etc. It has also observations on biological things like fruits, flowers, etc. During the reign of Babur's grandson, Akbar, the Tuzuk-e-Babri was translated into Persian called Babur Nama. So, Babur was a good, successful and strong ruler. His foundations for the Mughal Empire were strong, good. But still, he could rule only for 5 years. Yeah. So, let's know about his successor, Humayun. Humayun, the eldest of Babur's 4 sons, was nominated the empire, or Babur's successor to the throne. Humayun inherited a vast empire, very vast empire, which stretched from Kabul in the west to Bihar in the east, and from the Himalayas in the north to Gwalior in the south. It was a weak empire without cohesion and stability. Actually, Humayun did not have the qualities of a good general. He lacked the qualities that were necessary to maintain such a large empire. So, he was also surrounded by enemies in all sides. Okay, so what happened to Babur? What happened to Humayun is, he was covered by enemies on all the sides. He was very generous to his brothers. According to Babur's wish, he divided the kingdom into parts and gave it to his brothers. But still, his gratitude-less brothers actually went hostile against him and plotted against him. So now what? Babur was surrounded by enemies. If Afghan chiefs within the empire were ambitious and rebellious, the most dangerous Sher Shah Suri, who was fast gaining power and had a sight which was set firmly on the Mughal Empire's throne. So, if the Afghan chiefs Sher Khan Suri are on one side, then on the other side is Babur Shah, Bahadur Shah of Gujarat. And Malwa was a powerful ruler whose aim was to capture Delhi and become the ruler of India. So, Babur was surrounded. He can't go there, he can't come here. That was the situation of our Humayun. Actually, this story related to Babur's death, actually it's not validated by any facts. This is a story. So at the end of Babur's life, his eldest son, Humayun, fell seriously ill. So what did Babur do? Babur performed a religious ceremony to transfer his son's illness to himself. So this actually worked. As Humayun got healthy, Babur's situation became worse. So like this, after 2 or 3 months, Babur died in Agra on 26 December 1530 CE. Babur was buried in Kabul in accordance to his dying wishes. So this is the story. It's not validated by any facts. So, military expeditions. Let's see what are the expeditions, the fights, the battles that Humayun fought to expand his empire and protect his empire. Attack on Chunar. Humayun turned his attention to the Afghan chief Sher Khan. He attacked the fort of Chunar, a stronghold of the fiercely ambitious Sher Khan. The siege was abandoned 4 months later in order to deal with Bahadur Shah of Gujarat. Sher Khan was allowed to keep the fort in order for a promise for loyalty to the Mughals. So, what a situation. When Humayun attacked here, Bahadur Shah attacked there. But still, Humayun gave the fort again to Sher Khan with a false promise that he'll do some help for the Mughals. Again, conquest of Gujarat and Malwa. Humayun marched against Bahadur Shah and captured the whole of Gujarat and Malwa. Bahadur Shah fled without offering any resistance. So Humayun fought against Bahadur Shah and Bahadur Shah ran. So he sinked. Loss of Gujarat. Again, taking advantage of Humayun's absence from Agra, Sher Khan strengthened his position in Bengal and Bihar and became very powerful. When the news had reached Humayun that Sher Khan had invaded Bengal, he left Gujarat and Malwa in the hands of his brother and marched against Sher Khan to teach him a lesson. Again, Bahadur Shah returned and captured Gujarat and Malwa and throwed his brother. So this was the situation. If he go attack there, one will attack here, and if he attack here, one will attack there. Again, invasion of Bengal. Humayun spent 6 months besieging the Chunar fort. Meanwhile, Sher Khan invaded Bengal, captured Gaurav's capital. He took all the treasure he found there. Humayun reached Gaur unopposed and wasted many months in merrymaking. Meanwhile, his brother Hindal reached Agra and declared himself emperor. So what did Sher Khan do? Sher Khan cut off all the supplies of Humayun with Agra. Now Humayun had no communication with Agra. So, Battle of Chausa. Sher Khan had consolidated his position and was now ready to face Humayun, who could not retreat towards Agra. In 1539 CE, two armies faced each other at Chausa for 3 months. While negotiations for peace were on, Sher Khan launched a sudden attack. Humayun jumped into the Ganga with the water carrier's inflated water bag. So now, what happened? Sher Shah attacked Humayun, and Humayun jumped into the Ganga with the water carrier's inflated water bag and escaped. So there was one more battle of Kannauj. Encouraged by his success in the Battle of Chausa, Sher Khan planned another attack on Mughal forces and made elaborate military preparations. In 1540 CE, the Mughals were decisively defeated very badly by Sher Khan this time. Sher Khan assumed the title of Sher Shah. The large but fragile Mughal Empire came to an end and was replaced by Afghan. So sad. Again, Afghan rule came into power. So, Humayun jumped into the Ganga. Where did he go? Did he die? Or was he still alive? So, Humayun's exile. For the next 15 years, Humayun wandered from place to place, in search of shelter. As I said, his cruel brothers refused to give him shelter. In 1542 CE, in a small town named Amarkot in Sindh, a son named Akbar was born to him. And his wife, Amida Banu, who he had married at the time of his exile. So now, Humayun finally left India and found refuge and assistance in the court of the Persian Emperor. Humayun got tired of India and went to Persia. Again, but don't think that Humayun went there permanently. Humayun returned. With military help from Shah of Persia, Humayun returned and reconquered Kabul, Kandahar from his brother Kamran. Kamran was blinded and sent to Mecca. By 1544 CE, Humayun had consolidated his position in Afghanistan. Sher Shah died in 1545 CE. His successors were weak and incompetent. So, taking advantage of the situation, Humayun returned to India and recaptured Delhi and Agra in 1555 CE. Humayun died shortly afterwards in an accidental fall from his library. So, before we learn about Akbar, let's learn about Sher Shah's brilliant 5 years reign. As you all know, Sher Shah decisively defeated Humayun in the Battle of Kannauj in 1540 CE and drove him out of the country. He ascended Delhi under the title of Sher Shah and established Afghan rule in India. So, who is Sher Shah? What is his history? How was his early life? Okay. Sher Shah was the son of Hasan Khan, a Jagirdar of Sasram in Bihar. Originally named Farid Khan, he was given the name of Sher Khan when he single-handedly killed a tiger. So brave. He joined the Mughal army when Babur invaded India and learned the techniques of Mughal Empire, Mughal warfare. Taking advantage of political instability and following Babur's death, Sher Shah established his kingdom and authority in Bihar and Bengal. Sher Shah was very much determined to drive out Mughals from India and re-establish Afghan rule. He defeated Humayun in the Battle of Chausa and in the Battle of Kannauj and occupied the throne of Delhi in 1540 CE. 1540 CE and 1545 CE, Sher Shah conquered Malwa, Punjab, Rajputana, Multan, Sindh. During the siege of Kalinjar in 1545 CE, he died in an accidental explosion of gunpowder, bringing an end to a brief but brilliant 5-year reign. Again, within 10 years of Sher Shah's death, Humayun returned and recaptured his countries, as I said before. Sher Shah's administration. Sher Shah was a brilliant organizer both in civil and military affairs. He built his administration on the basis of a welfare state. Welfare state. Nowadays almost every country is based their constitution on welfare state. Central administration. Sher Shah was the supreme head of the central government. He divided the government into several departments. Each department was under the charge of a minister who was assisted by other officials. Sher Shah was always very active. He himself, by walk, went on regular tours of inspection of his country. Sher Shah set a very efficient spy system. Provincial administration. Sher Shah divided the empire into 47 provinces or sarkars. Each province was further subdivided into districts or parganas. Each pargana was made up of a number of villages. Each sarkar was placed under an Afghan chief. In every pargana, there were several officials whose work was supervised by Shikdar-e-Shikdarid and Munsif-e-Munsifan. The Shikdar was responsible for law and order in the general administration, and the Munsif looked after the collection of revenue and civil cases. The villages were looked after by panchayats composed of village elders. Sher Shah kept in touch with the villagers through village officials like Patwaris and Mukadams. So let's see about the military organization of our Sher Shah. Sher Shah established a large standing army and introduced measures to make it strong, disciplined, efficient. He took personal interest in the appointment and training of his soldiers. The salaries of the soldiers and the officers were fixed according to their skill and ability. Alauddin Khilji's system of branding horses, dagh, and maintaining a descriptive role of the soldiers, chehra, was revived by Sher Shah. The army was divided into many units and was placed under a commander. Garrisons were set up in different parts of the empire. The cavalry and infantry were highly trained, disciplined, and well equipped with artillery. Communication system. Sher Shah built an excellent network of roads, mainly to facilitate the quick movement of troops throughout the empire, to promote trade and commerce, and yes, to make traveling easier and comfortable. The Grand Trunk Road that Sher Shah built was the longest and most important of the four major roads that he built. It connected Sonargaon in modern Bangladesh in the east to Peshawar in modern Pakistan in the northwest. Shady trees were planted on both sides of the roads, and rest houses, sarais, and wells were built at regular intervals for travelers and merchants. The sarais were also used as dak chowkis, post houses. Two horsemen were always kept ready at post houses to carry royal messages to different parts of the country. Trade and commerce. The construction of roads in sarais greatly helped in the growth of trade and commerce. To give trade a further boost, all duties except two were abolished. Okay, the first duty was levied when the goods were bought into the country, and the second was levied when the goods were sold. Sher Shah instructed his officials to treat merchants well and look after their interest. The zamindars and the village headmen were made responsible for the lives of traders and merchants. New weights and measures were introduced. Coins of gold, silver and copper were of a uniform standard were introduced. The silver coin issued by Sher Shah, called the rupiah, was so well made that it remained standard coin even after his death for many centuries. Again, Sher Shah was a staunch believer in justice. Everyone was treated equally. The criminal law was harsh and punishments were severe. This was done to deter people from committing crimes. The village headmen and the local chieftains were made responsible for any crime that took place in their area. They were severely punished if they failed to track down a robber or a murderer. So harsh. The methods that Sher Shah used were ruthless, but were very effective. Revenue system. Sher Shah's greatest achievement is his great revenue system. Several reforms were introduced to improve the existing system. Land assessment. The land was carefully surveyed and measured every year. The average produce was calculated on the basis of its fertility.